Well, it's in, but it doesn't fit. They've jeopardised my build. Had I been mortgaged here, I'd have to stop.
Cheers.
He does need a break, but he won't get one. So he's just got to keep on with it.
But you see, it's all about getting it right. This is just part of this love-hate relationship that I've got with this building.
In the last series of Grand Designs, we followed the fortunes of Tom Perry as he attempted to build one of the most ambitious houses in Britain, a true technological wonder of the age. During the year that we filmed him, he just about managed to get the roof on. I was desperate to see this project through to completion, and so for this series, we've decided to come back and dedicate an entirely new programme to Tom's build, and what promises to be a roller coaster ride, hopefully to completion. Let's begin by recapping the story so far. Tom is taking on possibly the most ambitious and complicated house I've ever seen. It's multi-angled and it's crowned by an extraordinary floating wing-shaped roof. The house is in two sections, separating the bedrooms from the living area. The entrance will appear to have a stream running through it. Upstairs is one open-plan kitchen sitting room with vast windows, natural materials, and exposed structural steelwork. From here, you go up a level and into the bedroom wing. This will have four bedrooms, five bathrooms, and a study. And the whole place is going to have every high-tech gadget in the book. Tom won't say what it'll cost, but if he gets change from a million, I'd be surprised. And it's all privately funded. That means no mortgage. It's a challenging and beautiful building. And it's a far cry from the suburban semi where Tom and Judy now live with their two young children.
It's going to be a very big leap, isn't it, for you? With respect, you're not in your...
Careful.
In our 20s.
In your first flush.
Third flash, I think, probably.
No, it's a midlife crisis.
It is, yeah. Full blown. It was, you know, it was either this down here or a Ferrari in the mistress, and Judy won. We start on November the 19th.
And when do you finish?
July the 2nd.
July the 2nd.
We move in July the 2nd. Bah.
Tom is a self-made man, a wheeler-dealer and marketeer. And although he has no experience of the building trade, he's chosen to take full responsibility for this ambitious project and spend every day on site.
OK. Jim. Bye.
I hear the ringing in my ears of, you know, only a fool represents himself in court. One wonders whether there's any parallel here on site.
The build begins in November 2001. Nothing is conventional about this project. Tom's using an industrial technique for his foundations, steel piles which are hammered into the ground.
And he'll now just drive it down then, next one on top, and just keep going.
That's it.
Until he's hit the chalk.
Yep.
However far down that is.
But Tom hits problems from the word go. The tubes need to be sunk a lot deeper than anyone expected. And completing the foundation base for this house takes a whole 2 months longer than he's planned. But no one can doubt his determination.
It's been a hard week so far, for sure. In fact, it's been a rather hard 10 days, to be honest. It's been, you know, quite challenging, quite stressful, quite emotional.
The house Tom's building was designed by architect David Grindley.
David had the vision of doing it as he's designed it, and yeah, I've now got the headache. It's great, isn't it? Client ends up with the headache of the bill.
Yeah, well, I think Tom's picked quite a complicated building to kind of learn the construction industry from.
I was given quite a complicated building to learn the construction industry from, David.
Tom's next experience of the construction industry is that his brickies up and leave the site for another job. And by the time Tom gets a new team on site, he discovers he's been a bit late putting in an order for his steel.
This means work can't continue, and the site is abandoned again. To cap it all, shortly afterwards, Tom goes and sells the family home, without telling anyone.
Where are we going now, Tom?
I have to say, I didn't expect that we'd sell it.
This is a man who will always hold out to get the best deal. He does it on the bills, and he's doing it with the family home, haggling over the rental contract to the last minute.
We haven't got the keys. Hopefully, we'll exchange when we get over there. We're presently waiting for the estate agent's office to open at 9 o'clock. And then they're going to meet us at the property. I will hand over a cheque. They will hopefully hand over a contract that's correct. It will hopefully get signed. We will hopefully move in. A bit close to the wire.
In May 2002, 6 months into the project, the steelwork arrives. Every piece has been made to Tom's specification, and the measurements have to be precise.
So far, this very complicated build had had its fair share of problems, par for the course. But the steelwork, which Tom had measured up for, fitted. It was a vindication of his role as site manager, and he felt good about that. But he was not prepared for the nightmare that was to come.
The most unique aspect of Tom's building is the highly distinctive bird's wing roof. But Tom's got through 23 separate contractors before he finds one ready to take on this job.
It's the signature of the property. It's wonderfully exciting. It really is.
Fitting this roof is a critical moment in the build. It arrives on site in November, and the day starts badly.
Why didn't he just say, because I could have had it here in 15 minutes? I'm not joking.
What, have they come without tools?
They've got no tools.
Oh, God.
Can you believe it? We've got an ideal weather window opportunity here, and nothing's happening.
As well as tools, the fitters are missing a vital piece of paperwork.
Can you see anything on there? Huh? Because I can't. Isn't that remarkable?
I thought he was going to be a bit better today, but I think he's pretty stressed at the moment.
This is a joke.
I hope he survives till the end of the build.
I mean, it's amateur night. And it will be night before we get the first section up there. Jason! If you take it to him and you get
the timber underside of this roof is the finished living room ceiling, so it just can't get damaged. They managed to get half on before nightfall, but there's an even worse day ahead for Tom. The one thing he absolutely wanted to avoid was putting this roof up in the rain. And to cap things off, he's twisted his ankle.
Oh, dear. You know, if we get stains on the back of this birch ceiling downstairs, it'll be forever there, you know? Can't get rid of it, so I'm very twitchy about it, to be frank.
Tom's limits are being tested.
I just don't believe it. I have spent too much time on sites, and I know what the bloody game is. Don't piss me about. Get it sorted. When you have, give me a call.
So, superficially, the roof looks all right. I mean, it's up. There are quite a few drops of water hanging off the underside.
Yep.
There are some joints which look very damp, where it looks like the water's actually crept into the grain.
From behind.
There seem to be almost a few mildew marks.
Yep.
Again, from water that's crept into the end grain of the timber.
Yep. Thanks, Kevin, for pointing that out. You know, I'm in the middle of a very bad dream. This is meant to be a sort of pleasurable experience for me.
What are you going to do? I mean, this underside is, well, I won't say it's ruined, but it's severely damaged, really.
Yes.
Considering it's the final finish that you're going to look at.
Yes.
Are they going to come back and fix it or what?
They're going to be given every opportunity to fix it, okay? All the other thing to do is really lift it off here and have a jolly good bonfire. So that's really it.
So all in all, it's a right royal, 5-star.
Fur-lined, ocean-going, balls up.
At the end of a year-long struggle, Tom and Judy have only half a shell of a building, with a leaking roof. But with a resolve I can only marvel at, they hunker down for the long haul.
I suggested to Tom that as the summer's coming, we should not pay rent anymore, but we maybe have a caravan on site.
Are you happy about living in the caravan during next winter?
No.
Which means you have to be.
Well, so we have to be. We'll be in by July, won't we, Tom?
Oh, yeah.
So another July deadline. A battle-weary Tom and still a mountain to climb. It's now March 2003, and we're back to follow Tom's battle all over again. It's taken the past 3 months to get the roof correctly fitted, so any hope of moving in by July is long gone.
So tell me how you are, how the build is.
We finally got over the Beecher's Brook of the project so far, which has been the gulbing roof, and it's on.
The roof may be on the mend, but Tom's broken again.
Oh, what's this?
Yes, well, I'd like to sort of say that I spoke to one of the two recalcitrant contractors we've had on site, but sadly I sort of came out of the site office at speed. My ankle went and I put my arm out and that was it.
How are things domestically, really?
Domestically, better. Now I know we don't have to move into a caravan for a while.
Is that so?
Yes, we did actually go and look at some, and we saw one that was bigger than we had on holiday. Yeah. It was a special dining
bigger,
area, and
brief.
He looked at it and he said, "Oh, yes, this is OK, I can work from here." And I said, no, this is going to be home. We can get rid of the site office. And I started to think perhaps wasn't such a good idea.
So I didn't ask you when you're going to finish. Well, what do you think, this year? 2003?
Yes.
People do keep saying, when's the house going to be finished?
Yeah, boring question, really, I guess.
It becomes very tiresome, actually.
It is a bit. Yeah. And how are things going, and how is the roof? Quite a few people have asked.
Tom's roof really is one of a kind. Its unusual shape is a major design feature in the house.
It really has this very interesting feeling. What do you make of that?
It's like standing underneath a 747 wing.
Isn't it?
Wow.
It's wonderful, and you sort of think, well, you know, it's floating.
And I know the scaff's still there, but when that goes down, I mean, the thing, it looks almost supernatural, the fact that it sort of floats.
Yeah.
And you're just doing that protective coating on the outside strip there?
Absolutely.
This, though, is still kind of cruddy, isn't it?
Yeah. It's been up for the thick end of 3 months, and it's had a lot of rain get through it, unfortunately, and it shows. Thank you very much.
The damage is going to force the uncompromising Tom to compromise. The roof was delivered with the final finish intact, but now he's going to have to resort to sticking a veneer to his expensive birchwood ceiling. Fortunately, the surface on the top side is in much better shape.
And here is the gull wing.
That looks nice, doesn't it? The steel
isn't
looks
this great?
Good. Lovely shape.
It looks wonderful, doesn't it?
Ooh. Very beautiful. I like that sweeping shape.
Lovely, isn't it? Mm.
The innovative roof also incorporates groundbreaking materials. The plywood structure is covered with a moisture-permeable membrane that provides sound insulation and keeps the roof ventilated.
So how do you feel now that you've got the roof on and it's watertight?
Delighted. Beecher's Brook is out of the way. I really do feel as though I'm on the home run, and with this out of the way, I could really cope with anything after that.
I bet you probably could.
I think so.
But all this innovation has meant that every step of Tom's progress has been fraught with difficulties. He's been at this now for a year and a half, and he's only just got his roof on. And there are still gaping holes in half of the building.
He really could do with a break. He's been on site all day, every day, for almost 18 months now. Usually he walks in, well, you can just tell that he's just exhausted. He walks in, he just wants to shower and eat and more or less go to bed. He does need a break, but he won't get one. Yeah, so he's just got to keep on with it.
The house consists of two blocks. The bird's wing roof sits on one of them, and now it's finally in position, measurements can be taken for the acres of glass that'll seal the building. Manufacturing these huge panes is going to take quite a while. But the other block has a far simpler roof, and the glass is already fitted, so in here, tradesmen can get to work.
It's quite a shock, isn't it? I mean, you know, normally it's been sort of welcome to the Mary Celeste, but yes, we've got a lot going on today.
The wiring in this place is not a simple job. Tom wants the lighting and ventilation throughout the house to be electronically controlled by a sophisticated intelligence system. What he's installing is normally only found in large, exciting, high-tech buildings. The systems react to the weather outside and change the heating, lighting and ventilation inside to suit. Tom being Tom, he wants this degree of sophistication in his house. And rather ambitiously, he's designed the system that'll run it.
I know you can put data voice, then Cat 5, Cat 6, whatever, but TV, I know nothing about.
There you go. Don't worry. I know, you see, there's a first time for everything, isn't it? Just
And when it's in the wall and doesn't bloody work, Tom, it's not my fault.
Shh. Just don't get stressed.
Oh, no. Tom says it'll work.
Just like that.
So Tom takes a wrap.
I take the wrap. Yeah, no sweat. No sweat.
Wiring continues throughout the whole of July. It isn't until the first week of August that the first fix electrics are finished.
So how many miles of cable have you got in this building? Have you worked it out?
Well, I'm now working on new money. It's 11 and a half kilometres. Quite a lot. Yeah, this is one of the distribution panels. We have two on this floor.
On
this floor?
That distribution panel does half of this floor?
Well, it does half of this building. We have two distribution panels on this floor. One half does the upper floor, one half does the lower floor on this northern side.
But that doesn't include the main building?
No, there's another one over there.
But what's it all doing? Lighting?
Absolutely. Heating. We have environmental control throughout. We have 21 heating zones in the house. Or is it 24? I sort of lost count, really. But we have quite a few. We have to control the blinds. Don't forget, we have a house here which has 65% glass in the vertical surfaces. And if we don't have very efficient controls in this building, we will cook.
So how long does it take to put all this stuff in so far?
Well, we've been at this now for about 4 weeks, 4.5 weeks. Well, that's for three men.
Tom, what do all of these cables do?
Well, the two black cables here.
Yeah.
Those go to the two distribution boxes in the northern building.
Right.
So those are the power to distribute throughout the northern side. These ones over here are all to do with...
The grey ones.
The grey ones, yeah. Okay, the white ones and the light green ones. Those all link back to the garage, which is the hub for that particular side. Right.
Which is the distributor under here.
That's it, goes over under here.
All around here, right. So this is... My goodness. This is what here? This is everything coming together? This is all power cables here?
Yeah, we have power cables here, and this is principally for this side of the building.
Right.
We've got voice and data here. Right. We've got video and sound distribution here.
We mean from kind of stereo and CD and all that kind of stuff?
That's absolutely right, yes. So we've got sound going throughout the house and also video systems throughout the house.
Right.
More voice and data down here. We have entry systems down
this is,
there.
I thought this was loose coiled.
No, Kevin, as if.
It's all coming up through the floor.
It's all coming up through the floor. And this green one here, which is part of the intelligence system.
You don't have a single computer.
No, absolutely not.
Driving this thing, sat here.
No.
Or a little man.
It's distributed. So in other words, it's in each switch and each actuator, there is a chip.
So each switch is intelligent?
Each switch is
intelligent. Like a little miniature computer?
Absolutely.
There is another benefit to this technology. Tom can link sound and lighting to help Judy, who's losing her hearing.
You know, I realise that what I can do with this green cable and the lighting system within the house is to help Jude when her hearing gets even worse, which it's likely to do, so that I can make a light in each room react on the phone ringing and the entry system ringing. What she can then do is she can choose how she answers the front door. She can use the phone, she can use the entry system, and press the button there, or she can just pick up the phone, dial 85 and let the person in.
Who's designed this whole thing?
Well, I've linked all these bits together, frighteningly. I mean, you know, bearing in mind that give me two wires and I can blow up a small town, you know. it's a bit of a concern. So, yeah, it's me. I know it looks a bit like an explosion in a spaghetti factory at the moment, but it all works.
It's not plugged into anything. It doesn't work yet.
Tom's ambition is extremely high, but then so are his standards and his determination. His unorthodox house has got a lot of windows in it, which are going to be fitted with blinds, but on the outside. These will sit in metal frames, and today the frames are due to be fitted. Tom is having to make last-minute adjustments.
But you see, it's all about getting it right. This is just part of this love-hate relationship that I've got with this building. Okay, ease up slowly, Dan. I'll keep an eye on the jib. Stop. Jib out. No, the holes aren't lining up anywhere, are they?
The frames don't fit, and Tom's also not happy with the finish. It looks like the highly polished surface has been put on what will be the back of the frames. Even though it'll delay progress, he's sending them all back to the factory.
I want it right. And if anybody wants to come here thinking it's not going to be right, well, they're going to be sadly disappointed. Or I'll, you know, accept, you know, 80%. No, it's got to be 99.8. And about does, really, I think.
These kind of standards aren't easy to maintain, especially when the plans for the house are still evolving. The latest idea is to introduce yet another piece of technology, but this one is specifically for Judy.
Possibly thinking about doing is having a loop system put into the sitting room, because my hearing is deteriorating, and it will only go downhill from here.
This new system will have microphones stationed throughout the house. The idea is that they pick up sounds from anywhere and transmit them directly to Judy's hearing aid.
Right.
With all the other electrical wizardry going into the house, Judy calls in a consultant to see if it's all going to be feasible. Right.
You've obviously a lot of data cables running around in here. This may cause interference.
Right.
And it's something we don't know until it's up and running and we actually test it.
Right. So does that mean I could get it? We've got these data cables in the
bedrooms,
all over the house.
It could well be.
Could get it anywhere. Oh. Oh, dear.
But Tom and his building face a much more serious problem.
The insurance company who will provide Tom with an insurance policy, they contacted Tom to say they were very concerned at the water damage that had potentially been caused by the bad weather. As a result of that, we need to get two reports basically saying that the bad weather doesn't compromise the structure.
Good hope. Thank you very much.
The insurance certificate guarantees the house is well built, and it is essential that the owner has this to be able to borrow money against the property and be able to sell it.
My 10-year guarantee insurer has threatened now to reduce or to withdraw our insurance.
On the whole building?
On the whole building. It means that should I ever wish to go and get a loan against this building, no one will touch it. And should we ever wish to move to the south of France within 10 years of the building being practically completed, no one will be able to get a mortgage to buy it. So I'm not very happy, to say the least.
As well as wrestling with this difficult build, Tom now has to placate his worried insurance company. This is one epic struggle.
Is there a battle to be won here? Is there a war to be won?
None of this is very much fun. It's very rewarding, but it does have that feeling of being like a salmon trying to get upstream. The current is always going against you.
When he's had a bad day, and I think, God, you know, this is just taking it out of him. What state is he going to be in when the house is finished? Will he be in a state to enjoy it?
So what do you describe as a victory here?
The victory. Finished, beautifully completed, family in loving living here, and with my 10-year guarantee insurance in place. Otherwise the buggers will get a big kick up the arse. That'll be it. Full stop.
Is it all over?
No. Isn't.
No, it isn't.
Isn't, no.
There is rarely good news for Tom. His insurance company have been in touch and they are going to withdraw his guarantee. Tom's lodged an appeal, but it could take months to be decided. The only reason he can continue with the project is because he isn't borrowing money to build the house.
They've jeopardised my build. Had I been mortgaged here, I'd have to stop. Be in all sorts of The only way I can borrow against this asset is to knock the building down that sits on the land. Then I can borrow money against the land. How bizarre is that for you? Someone said to me the other day, you know, Tom, will you do this again? And I said, I've got no bloody need to. I have no intention of going anywhere near another building.
This is Tom and the family's second summer on the build. The original schedule had them moving in 13 months ago.
Here we are working furiously during rather warm weather. And nice to have it. There's no criticism of that. But, you know, I'd rather be just sort of sitting and not doing much and not having to think about much and not having to think about programmes and schedules and window profiles and things like that. I just like to sit and, you know, read a bit.
Tom may be working every hour God sends, but he's building a big and complicated house and everything takes a long time. Although the roof went on last winter, 9 months ago, no major structural work has taken place since. Until now.
It's the end of August and it's a big day today. This place is crawling with people and they are not putting in wiring. They're putting in the steel frames for the windows on the south block. And they are also, at long last, putting in the glass.
Tom's been waiting for this very expensive delivery for 16 weeks. Like everything on this house, the glass is epic. There's 175 square metres of double-glazed, coated, toughened glass.
It's going to look lovely. It really is. It's going to look absolutely stunning. Yeah. I just want to get it in, you know. I mean, that's it for me. I just want to get it in.
So is this job complicated?
The shapes, the sizes, everything's different here. There's always... unexpected.
So how long are you expected to be here?
We're hoping to be another 2-3 weeks.
Weeks?
Yeah.
Putting it in. I think they're going to say days.
No.
It's too early to see if Tom will be happy with the glass, or if it'll even fit. But he's definitely not happy with his stainless steel balconies. Not only is he sending them back, he's changing his supplier.
Did you drive them down in price? Did you get a cut deal on this?
No, you don't get a cut.
You reckon you paid a fair whack for it?
Oh, yes, I know I did. Because, you know, I've compared it. You see, what I've now done is I've gone to a specialist stainless steel engineering company. Yeah. They've given me a price.
Yeah.
It's marginally more, I would say about 20% more, but it won't be by the end of this afternoon. It'll be rather less than that.
And they'll take the hit that you negotiate. My point is that if you pay 100 quid for an item and you negotiate the price down for that item to 75, the manufacturer, in the end, wants to give you 75 quid's worth of goods.
No, he doesn't.
Not 100 quid's worth of goods.
No.
And so you'll always end up with a slightly shoddy product.
More frequently with British companies, unfortunately, you're paying for sort of a good percentage of inefficiency. OK, now I'm just keen to engineer that out.
The past 2 years have taught me that Tom is a deal-maker extraordinaire. But I really do wonder if his tough tactics have contributed to some of the problems and delays with this build. As the glass begins to go in, another absolutely crucial process gets underway, the external rendering. As expected, Tom's using another innovative construction method.
Putting the render onto
the polystyrene.
Because normally the polystyrene goes either in a conventional build between two skins of blockwork or it goes on the inside of the building, but you're sticking it on the outside of the building.
That's right, yeah.
And you're rendering straight onto the top of this.
That's right.
The exterior walls of this house are going to be crisp, modern and bright white. The coat of render being applied needs to be perfect to match the clean lines of the glass and steel. It's October. Instead of being a 2 week job, after 5 weeks, the glass fitters are barely halfway through. Which means after nearly 2 years, this building is still not even watertight. And Tom and Judy now have a problem with their rented house, which means yet another upheaval for the family.
You've got an extension where you are, haven't you?
We had an extension. We were supposed to be there for 6 months. We've been there for 18 months now. And we can't extend again. So, in 2 weeks' time, we'll be moving into a mobile home on site.
And what do the children think of that?
I
I think they're quite happy for the novelty, but I don't know what they'll be like after a few weeks. Mm. But hopefully it won't be too long.
And Tom, other people do. I mean, how is Tom about it?
Tom's not happy at all. He really is not looking forward to it. He likes to get home, wind down.
I mean, does he have a difficulty, as it were, mentally escaping the project?
Yes. I don't think he can mentally escape it at all.
I almost dare not ask the question, but when do you think you'll be moving in?
I have no idea. In the future.
That's what he says.
I know. Well, I don't know.
No.
He thinks that he's hoping maybe before Christmas, but I can't see that happening. Can you?
Maybe Easter.
Oh, God.
I'm having a sign made up at the moment saying readings and tarot cards. Is it tarot cards? we've gone for a mobile home, and it's terribly Essex. It's one of Essex's best, I'm pleased to say, and I'm proud to be living in it, to be frank with you.
It doesn't make any difference to you, does it? You're only living in
No, 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 I don't. I go down to the pub for a quiet drink, hour each evening, that's it.
Well, you do at the moment, because then you've got a very comfortable home to go to, where you can put your feet up, watch television, have some nice hot food, relax, rest, get away from it. You won't be able to do that here. You'll be on site, bang next door. You look out the window. Every time you open your eyes, you'll see this place.
It may encourage me to get it done even faster.
This project has beaten the hell out of Tom. He's twisted both ankles and broken his wrist. And now, just when his reserves are at their lowest and his creature comforts are evaporating, he's having surgery as part of his ongoing battle with diabetes.
So it's not so much the build, then, that's causing this?
No, this is nothing. This is nothing. This is build-free. This is without the build. You know, with the build, I can inflict a great deal more damage on myself than that.
Yeah, like sticking the angle grinder in your knee.
falling over outside, breaking my arm.
Breaking your arm.
Yeah. This started right at the beginning of the job. Okay. What it is, you lose your grip, which I really don't like the thought of at
Interesting
all.
Interesting metaphor, yeah, right?
Absolutely. And so, you know, I'm now going to start getting it back, which is good. But, you know, you have to go through a bit of pain to get there.
Yeah, just as the build comes to close, you get a grip on it.
Wouldn't that be great?
As they're moving again, Tom and Judy are packing up and selling off their remaining possessions. Nothing they own would suit the new house, nor, for that matter, the caravan.
So I think that's it. I'm done. I'm out of here. I can get that sorted out this afternoon. Good. Okay.
Tom said he feels as if this is home to him, that it isn't home to me. It's just a place where we happen to be living, and we've got our things around us, but it doesn't really feel like home to me. So. I want home.
At 35 foot by 10, it's a home of sorts, and one they've managed to avoid having for nearly a year. But no longer. With winter approaching, the caravan has finally made it onto site.
Yeah, I admit I've changed the goalpost slightly, but, you know, client's prerogative and all that. I want the line about here, so the door entrance will be about there, which means I can see any slackers in the site hut. Apparently we're going to be serving eggs and bacon each morning here, apparently, according to the guys. I think that's a remote likelihood.
It's now November, and the Perry family have been in their caravan for a fortnight.
Tom, you've got a new home. It's got no scaffolding, look. It's so shiny.
Isn't it great?
It's great. It's very close to your house, isn't it? I suppose you can just skip out of the door onto site.
Skip out of the door, yes. I don't know that I'm skipping anymore.
Now, how's the build? How's the house?
The build is pretty good, actually. We've got lots of people here doing things and all being very productive, and we seem to be progressing.
What about the glass? Have you got a light in it? Is it all hunky-dory?
No. We'll have a chat about that upstairs, shall we?
Well, come and show you. Is it in?
Have you at least got it in? Yeah, let's go and have a look.
Incredibly, the team fitting the glass have been on site now for 9 weeks.
Well, it's in, but, it doesn't fit. Namely, those bits up there. Right. And these bits up here. The glaziers allege the roof has slumped by 40 mil since measuring it and fitting the glass.
That's about what? About that?
About that much. And that's a lot. In conjunction with the structural engineers, I discovered that The roof has not slumped. In fact, the position in which it's located is 1 millimetre above precisely where it should be, precisely where it should be.
You mean it's slumped upwards?
Upwards.
It's anti-gravitational.
It's anti-gravitational.
It's a truly flying roof.
It is a truly flying roof.
So the glass does not fit because the glass is wrong?
Yeah.
Rather than the roof being wrong?
Spot on.
So what are they going to do about it?
Well, they've got to come and take it out and replace it.
All over again?
All over again, yeah.
The 6 pieces of replacement glass are ordered, but they won't be ready for some time. This delay just means more time in the caravan.
Can I come in? Thanks.
Yes.
I'd better take my shoes off, hadn't I? Kitchen's all right.
Yeah. Cooker, fridge.
Nice living area.
Yes.
Big sofa.
Plenty.
I mean, the front door. It's probably the nicest mobile home I've ever seen.
Caravan, you mean?
Well, you can't bring yourself to call
it
a mobile
home.
It's
not really a mobile home, I don't think.
And how's Tom coping with it?
Tom's fine, actually. He says it's cosy and it's home. Temporary home, but it's home.
It's home. How long do you plan to be here?
I don't know. I think when the time comes when we do move in, we will really be ready for it.
Tom and Judy's schedule seems to have no end. They won't be in the house now until sometime in 2004. But there is a significant milestone ahead. The scaffolding is soon to come down and the building will be revealed. Tom's been staring at this scaffolding forever. But the time has finally come to see whether his complicated building is as elegant and beautiful as he originally dreamed. We've now made an unprecedented 2 films about this house, which I think must rank as one of the most ambitious self-builds in Britain. And I've been coming to visit Tom for over 2 years now. But today is the 1st of December. It's my last visit. This is it. Now, I know that he hasn't finished because they're still living in the caravan. But now that the scaffolding's down, this house looks magnificent. It is an utter transformation, isn't it? Now the scaff's down.
Well, it is, yeah. It's again sort of changed. It's got bigger for me now.
Has it?
Yeah.
Well, because you've probably introduced more light.
Well, perhaps so, yes. And also it's that transparency that you can see
right through the building to the other side. Yeah. That's very exciting. And I like now all the joints, the junctions between all these different materials.
And the layers.
Well, because this building was always intended to be very transparent, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Not just in terms of looking through it, but also because you could see the different materials and how they joined together.
And how they work.
It's like a building which has had its skin removed, you know, everything's kind of on show.
The detail is just, and it's still catching us out.
One thing that strikes me about this whole building as you come up, how is un-British in design, un-English it looks, even un-European. It's got a sort of almost Shogun kind of oriental quality because of the shape of the roof, you know. It's so unusual.
Do you know, it's being called a petrol station. I've had a storage unit. We've now got Shogun. I mean, goodness knows what else we'll get. It's great.
So can you show me around?
Yeah, sure. Let's go.
The north block houses 4 bedrooms, 5 bathrooms and a study. Its more conventional roof was the first part of the building to be completed.
Oh, this is lovely, Tom. You finished this bedroom block quite early, didn't you, the render?
Yes, quite early on, yes. So this has been around now for a while.
Yeah, it's beautiful, this sheer white cliff of render with that oversailing roof that looks as though it's from something else that's sliding over the edge.
Yep.
It's very, very powerful, very dynamic. It's lovely. And these windows are fabulous too because they're like a sort of ecclesiastical, like great cathedral windows stuck into it. Tremendous height.
A nice mix of colours.
Yeah, Yeah, the wood, the render.
And the grey.
And the grey. It really does look quite monumental, this. These, presumably, these are all your lights, aren't they?
Yes.
Still to go in.
Kevin, yes.
How many are there? Two or three dozen on this wall, I should think?
A few.
It's like a bloody aircraft runway.
Yep, thanks. Enough of that, round the corner.
Three times as many as you need. Oh, this is nice. Look, that's the new steelwork, isn't it? That's the perfect steelwork.
That's the replacement steelwork, and it's absolutely great. Yeah.
But blinking complicated.
Yeah.
And there's nothing about this building which is simple, is there?
Well, that's why it's taken 2 years, Kevin. I want to point that out, you know, because that's the only...
I thought there had to be a reason, Tom.
But it's lovely, isn't it?
It really is. From here, this is the most complicated side of the building at all, isn't it? I mean, it really does sort of articulate its way around here.
Yep.
And I love the way that the roof looks as though somebody's just lifted it off.
Yep.
And the walls have been sort of gently exploded out and filled with glass.
It's very pleasing.
Very, very pleasing. And you built it, Tom.
And I built it.
What a clever boy.
What a bloke.
Tom has built a sublime house, but I'm not sure I can forgive it for what it's done to him. And yet, through it all, his determination and tenacity have pulled it off, despite him starting as a rank amateur. Every detail of this construction is elegantly worked out, and the overall effect is entrancing. And with the combination of solid white rendered walls and glass and steel structures that seem to just float on top, there's an eye-catching contrast between the massive and the delicate. The labyrinth of angles and the quality of the engineering make it look as if the whole house is a complex mechanism which could change its size and shape. After 2 years, Tom's got the perfect exterior that he struggled so hard for. I just don't know how many more years he'll have to struggle to get the perfect interior. In here, however, it is quite a different story, isn't it? It's vaguely familiar, this scene.
Yes.
I've seen it before.
Yes, but there's glass in there now, Kevin.
Oh, hooray.
And there is progress being made.
Yes, Tom, yes, good. Yeah, I've heard that
Look
before
here.
Somewhere. Now that's more like it, Tom. That's beautiful.
It's great, isn't it?
Yeah, there's real progress.
Yeah.
And in here too, you plastered the back wall as well.
Plaster the back wall, yes.
Everything looks so much cleaner, doesn't it, when it's plastered? And no longer like a building site, more like a house, in fact, doesn't it?
Yes, it does.
And what happens next?
Well, we start on the underfloor heating. That happens now in January, which is a bit disappointing, but it gives us an opportunity to tidy a few things up.
Yeah.
So then we screed, and then...
I was going to ask you about the ceiling. You're going to veneer it, aren't you?
We are, yeah. We're going to do that once the heating is down.
Right.
The heating is down early January. We'll then turn the heating, get the heating on, let things dry out. We've got some adhesive which we're told will do the job.
You know, one thing that strikes me as very interesting about the space is the fact that, you know, when it was open, when it was it had no glass in it, you obviously felt connected to the outside world.
Yes.
Now it's glazed, strangely enough, that connection seems more strong.
I know, doesn't
yes.
it?
Yes, and especially now that all the scaffolding is down. That last bit really has made a difference. It's just fabulous. You look out and despite the mess out there at the moment, it is going to be fantastic. And it's just as nice from Lucy's room.
I see what you mean. Yeah.
Yes.
It is lovely, this room. The view is so uninterrupted. It's so
lovely,
perfect, isn't
it,
looking out across the landscape
yes.
like that? You know?
Yes.
And then she's also got this great big glass wall looking this way as well. You're not going to get rid of your children that easily, are you, with bedrooms like this? I mean, they've got that stonking view.
I'm a family man. We are family people. We like to keep the family close, you know?
Clearly.
She's only 8, but I think she'll be here till she's about 32. I can see the fiancé moving in.
And what about George?
No, George has said he's never leaving home, so we've certainly got him for a while.
Haven't you, just?
Yes.
George's bedroom is on the ground floor directly below, and while his sister gets a balcony, he'll have to settle for a patio. The corridor on the top floor of the bedroom block runs the length of the building to the master bedroom.
And you plastered the corridor as well?
Well, you see, we've got to have a good finish because we're shining lights off the walls.
All right. Yeah.
And, you know,
you've got to
get it right.
So this room is kind of like a mirror image of Lucy's room.
Yeah, just a bit
wider.
You've
got that view into the front garden here,
yes.
it is, and a view that way looking over the trees.
Yes. Yes.
Quite wonderful. Well, you chose the right architect for a highly detailed, beautifully wrought building, didn't you?
Yep.
But I'm wondering whether or not you got the right project manager.
No, he's a complete bloody pain in the arse.
I mean, it's a tough gig, Tom. Really difficult, complicated building. I stood outside there earlier. I was looking at the building. I thought, wow, the complexity. I mean, it's a beautiful piece of engineering. It's a piece of craftsmanship, this house.
Yeah, thank you.
And it's a tough call for somebody who's never built anything before. Well, and
we had no idea it was going to be this difficult.
No, we didn't, I have to say.
Nobody told you. Nobody said.
No.
You shouldn't be doing
it. Well, people build houses for themselves all the time.
For me, I told you.
Builders. But I thought Tom was going to manage the build, employ all the various contractors to do the work, and just supervise them and get the quotes.
Get the tea.
How do you feel about life in the caravan? Christmas, the new year, the spring. How prepared are you for the long haul?
It's not going to be a long haul. I'm sure it's not going to be a long haul. We're going to move in here as soon as we've got running water and doors and a bit of heat.
But I'm not going to even ask you how much this has all cost, because you've never told me, and I suspect you never will.
Do you know, I've been thinking about that, Kevin, and I really want to try and help you out. When we've finished, I'll probably be 3 times over budget.
Yeah.
Okay? Does that surprise you?
No. Well, it all depends on at what point you set that budget.
Yeah, that's true. So, you know, we are a tad over, but this is a fantastic stunner.
I'm glad you think that.
I think so.
I'm glad you're still in love with the building.
The love affair is all right at the moment. That's good. But God almighty, I wouldn't do it again.
Even if Tom doesn't fancy the self-build experience again, he's far from finished here. The tricky situation with his building's guarantee insurance is still to be resolved. And work's only just begun on the interior. Given his incredible standards, coupled with the continuing technical demands of the design, I'd be hard-pressed to say when Tom will finish this house. That must be hard for him.
But being the forgiving man that he is, he can still find space in his heart for this place, and he can still find the energy to get up every day and carry on. And what drives him forward, of course, is belief. It's belief in his original vision, and it's belief in what this place is slowly becoming. And that is an extraordinary 21st century house, built with love and with commitment and craftsmanship and real attention to detail. Those things are really rare in buildings. And of course, they also explain why it's still unfinished.
Hi, Derek Gill here. Tuesday night, I'll revisit and indulge my passion for all things Beatles. Test your knowledge in our special quiz. Share your memorabilia and stories with us. That's Tuesday from 7 p.m. on 774 ABC Melbourne and ABC Victoria.